Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. It's an honor to be here in India to give a talk on modular forms in a country where Ramanujan was spending lots of time with these marvelous functions. And the point is, why shall we study modular forms? So modular forms have many facets, and you can see them either as functions with an infinite set of symmetries, or you could see them as Q series with very nice arithmetical interesting coefficients. We've heard the word Ramanujan tau function, for example. And modular forms span a finite dimensional vector space. And so if you know the two modular forms coincide, let's say, with the first 10 coefficients, then you know they must be the same. And this allows you to prove identities just by miracle. And I'd like to motivate this with an example, which is due to Legendre. So you ask in how many ways you can write a number as a sum of four squares. So let's start with one. Oops, this is fine. Okay, so let's start with one. The one could be written as one squared plus zero plus zero plus zero squared. Or it could be written as minus one squared plus zero squared, zero squared, zero squared. And now we can move the one. And so altogether we get eight ways to write the one as the sum of four squares. And now we have an assignment that assigns to each natural number a value. And so we have something what is called an arithmetical function. And so we could now start looking at all of these numbers, and we could try to put these in a so-called generating series, which means that we take this sum here, and then it's an easy identity to see this is nothing else than the q to the square and this to the 4. Then we get all these numbers are 4. And then there's a miracle, and the miracle is that this can express by so-called Eisenstein series. And then the coefficient of these Eisenstein series are given by fairly easy function, namely by the divisors of a natural number. And the divisor should not be divisible by 4. And then there's an 8 before. And so this number can be calculated quite easily. For example, if you want to know in how many ways we could write this here in the number of squares, then we look at the divisors of 2019. And if I did not make a mistake, it should be this. And now we just sum over these divisors, and we get that there will be 21,568 possibilities to write this year as a sum of four squares. And so in order to prove this identity, you just have to check the first few values. The expert can calculate by heart. This is the dimension of the space of modular forms for gamma 0,2 and so on. So this number surely will suffice in order to prove this identity. And so this is a kind of identity that can be proved by means of modular forms. You have some nice function, which is counting usually something, and then you have another function coming from a different source. You know both are modular forms, you know the first coefficients coincide, then they must be the same. And what will we learn in this course? So I was not really clear how much you know in advance, and then I was advised to be very down to earth. And so my program is that at least want to cover 4 points. So I want to study the ring of modular forms. And This ring of modular forms has several characterizations, all of which are useful in different kind of areas. So the first one, it's just the classical one, and maybe some expert could tell me whether it was Riemann, Poincaré, or Fricke Klein who really proved this. I don't know. So the homework for the faculty is whose theorem is this? And so the next one is clearly due to Hecke. Hecke was a German mathematician who also was in Hamburg. And this is well known. The next one is a loose version of the so-called Shimura, or Eichler-Shimura theorem, which tells you that you can express modular forms in a simple way just by a couple of numbers, more precisely by polynomials, and everybody knows that polynomials are determined by their coefficients. And so there's only a few numbers, namely the coefficient of the period polynomial, determines you the modular form in all. So you have this modular form, which is a series with an infinitely many number of coefficients, and the miracle of the theory tells you that only a finite number of numbers allows you to reconstruct all the coefficients at all. Okay. WUK is a space of period polynomials. And usually you have this Eichler-Shimura isomorphism, you divide in the plus and the minus part of this space of period polynomials. And the fourth characterization is something that attracted in the last years the researchers again. This is a theorem by Don Saguier in the 1977 or something like that, that somehow got lost. And now it has to do with periods of modular forms, and this is what I'd like to at least to explain. So it's contained in between the lines of a very famous paper by Konen and Saguier. It was not really stated as a theorem in there. It is in another paper by Don Saguier, where it's also mentioned. And by the way, we see that the basis could be given by the following set. And this has analogous results in the theory of multiple zeta values. And multiple zeta values are real numbers that do generalize special values of the Riemann zeta function. And one of the first result was that this Riemann zeta function, which is the sum over 1 over n to the 2k, oops, sorry, and then, one, that this is expressible, okay, that this real number is expressible by powers of pi, and by some rational numbers, which are occurring a lot in mathematics, namely the Bernoulli numbers. And the miracle is that these numbers are all powers of pi, and so they don't get more complicated. So they sit in the ring of polynomials in Q zeta of 2, and so this kind of rationality result is something special for the even zeta values, whereas for the odd zeta values you expect that all these numbers are algebraically independent. And also there's a theorem with modular forms we won't touch that zeta 3 is irrational. So the people expect it's transcendental, but the best you can prove it's irrational. Okay, so these are the rough points we want to learn in this course, and I hope this will be fine. with respect to the organizers, and maybe we change, but I think this will be okay. And now modular forms is a very big field, and there's different schools, and I consider myself as being strongly influenced by Don Sagier. So Don Sagier is world famous for his work, in particular on modular forms, and so he can prove you all identity you show to him, which is reasonable. And he has very nice papers on modular forms, and I'd like to follow his lecture notes that are available at his homepage. And in particular, I like these lectures in Utrecht, which is a kind of unofficial paper, but it's available at his homepage. And somehow this paper was the basis for the more known papers in Waldschmidt. It's called Introduction to Modular Forms, or his paper in this 1-3 of modular forms, which also cover modular forms for Hilbert modular forms and Siegel modular forms. So it's one-dimensional, two-dimensional, and three-dimensional modular forms. And also this paper with Konen is available. Then there's a nice paper by François Martin and Emmanuel Royer. So it was made in a summer school also on modular forms. And at least in the slides, which I will put on my webpage after I erased all the mistakes, and maybe it could put on the ICTS page, there will be links to these papers. So you can get these papers all online. This was a kind of choice why I choose these papers, because I want to base on papers that will be available online worldwide without any restrictions. Okay. And of course, there are many excellent books. So maybe Shimura is very influential. And then there's a lot of work related to Fermat's last theorem, which is proven by attaching Galois representations to modular forms. And this is in this Cornell Silverman or in this Diamond Taylor. And the next topic is rather new. So it arose out of the paper of Gangel, Kaneko, and Sagier. And they proved some relation between identities in double setter values and modular forms, more precisely given a period polynomial, they can construct a relation, and this was a rather new result by that time. And they introduced the so-called double Eisenstein series. So, and this will be covered hopefully in the fourth lecture. And essentially is for the experts. You know that there are no modular forms of odd weights. And this is due to the fact if you, for example, consider 1 over n to the 3, but now you sum over all integers without 0, then it will be 0, because it will be sign cancelling, and this will be not a good idea. But on the other hand, you could sum over all n greater than 0, 1 over n 3, and now this gives you some non-vanishing number, and this will give you a highly interesting number. And the idea would be, now again for the expert, that for Eisenstein series, you put an order on the lattice, and this allows you to take Eisenstein series of weight 3, and the combinatorics will be the same of the Q series, but it won't be modular anymore. And now you could make this even with summing over cones in lattices, and this gives you rise to the so-called multiple Eisenstein series, and they do have very nice Q expansion with lots of combinatorial identities, and this is the subject I'm working on now since 5 years. And I just want to give you an introduction to this, what I consider to be a very amazing field in the last lecture. And this is connected to multiple zeta values, and in multiple zeta values has also been lots of interest, and this is due to the fact that Francis Brown has proven a nice theorem by using lots of theory like mixed state motifs and so on. And so that this has also impact to theoretical physics, and so there had been lots of summer schools on this, and out of this, this book by Burgos and Fresan was made, and again, this can be found online, and I'll try that you at least have access to this list of references. I think this afternoon, maybe I put it just the list of references I will put on my webpage, okay? So then you can take these and then you can start reading, and if you click in the PDF, you will find the references online. Okay. So that's the program for today and the next lectures. And so let's start. So the modular group is the group of integer 2x2 matrices with determinant 1. And they act on the upper half plane, which are the complex numbers which have positive imaginary part. And actually, this action is not free because minus 1 is acting trivially. And so for various points, sometimes you divide out the minus 1, and at some point it gives some technical issues or advances whether you do it or not. And I'm working with so-called level 1 modular forms for these lectures, and so they won't be a big issue whether I use gamma 1 or SL2Z. Okay, who has never seen modular forms before? Okay, everybody has seen, but maybe we continue. Okay, now, whenever you have a group acting on a space, then you could ask for the space of orbits. And this is called a fundamental domain. And in our case, this will be the points that are pictured in this calligraphical F for fundamental domain. And what does it mean? It means whenever you have a point in the upper half plane, you find a matrix that sends you the point in here. And also, if you have two points in this fundamental domain, you don't want them to be distinguished. No, that they can be mapped by an element of your group to another. And the only point is that at the boundary, you have some identification, and therefore you could graphically make this one a sharp line, and this one is just a dotted line, and really to indicate this is belonging, and this is just not belonging, but it's just in the interior. And so you have that every point can be mapped into in a point here. And what is the idea? So the idea is, first of all, you have to prove that your group is generated by these two matrices, and these matrices have a very nice action. So the one, the T, is just translating your point to the right by one. I think I have to do it in this thing. And the other one is it is a kind of mirroring at the circle, in the sense that the radius is getting to 1 over the radius, and the angle is just mirrored on this line from 0 to I infinity. So if you have a point here, then it will be go something like here. And these are the two matrices that generate everything. And now the idea is, okay, you start with a point. Let's see whether I can do this. So I have a point. Then it will be mapped to this new point by a certain t to the L. Oops, sorry, maybe not that nice. And now it will be put somewhere here. So it's one over r, if this is the distance r, and then we have this multiplication by this minus one. This has the effect, if I have a point here, then it will go to here with a minus one, and therefore this point will go here to S of tau 1. If this is tau 1 and this is tau 0. And now we make the same game again. We move it again inside this stripe. And then whether it's inside the circle, we have to map it outside with S, or if we can't map it outside with S, it has to be already in F. So this is just the way we get this Fundel domain. At once we know that this group is generated by these two matrices, but this is a kind of elementary exercise in linear algebra. And actually it's equivalent when saying you have this fundamental domain. And it is depends on your choice how you do it. Okay, so this is a kind of a first result. So you have this group acting on this upper half space. And why are people interested in studying the action of this group? So this came from the fact that people wanted to study elliptic curves. And so this is a kind of aside that people that may know something about elliptic curve can use this and fit this together. So a complex elliptic curve can be given as a torus, which is just a complex number by a lattice. And now you can scale these lattices, and you will get again a complex elliptic curve, which is isomorphic. And so now you can make a particular lattice, namely a lattice where one of the coordinates or one of the bases of this lattice is just a point in the upper half space. And then once you know this is the first period of your lattice, then you can just forget the lattice and you get to the upper half space. So it's somehow the point in the upper half space determines you a lattice. Or more precisely, it determines you the equivalence class of such a lattice, and this gives you a curve, and that it's really a maps of bijections and isomorphisms uses results like that every complex elliptic curve can be realized as a complex torus by this Weierstrass P function. So this is somehow why people are studying this action of SL2Z on this upper half space. Or maybe I forgot the following. If you have a lattice, then it is just can be depicted something like this. And then you have a lot of spanning set. Oops, sorry. You have a lot of spanning sets, and all these different spanning sets are just in correspondence by a matrix of SL2Z. And this is why you have this SL2Z action because the SL2 set leaves a lattice in C invariant. Okay, so you have this. The next point is there are various points of view on this modular forms, which will be defined soon. And one is coming from the fact that actually we are working with Riemann surfaces. And so you have this action of this group on the upper half space. You can extend this to the upper half space unified with the rational numbers together with infinite. And then you get a quotient which can be given a complex structure. And in particular, the orbit of this P1Q is just a point, and these points just correspond what the people call the cusp at infinity. This is also a nice point of this group action, but we won't touch this too much. But at various points, I will say, okay, modular forms are global sections of a line bundle. And those is just as an aside for the people that have heard about this, that they can put it into a picture. Okay, so this is how you can place this in the world of mathematics. And now we come back, what are modular forms? So modular, okay. It's even a mistake, it's a modular form, is a function, no, sorry, it was okay. Okay, a holomorphic function from the upper half space to C is called a modular form of weight k if it satisfies two additional assumptions. So the first one is that for all matrices in SL2 set, we have this functional equation, and this is somehow what we could see as saying that there's the infinitely many symmetries, because for all of these matrices, I have this functional equation, and I could view any of these functional equations as being a kind of inner symmetry of this function. And the second point is that these functions have a Fourier expansion, which is taking care of the boundary of the upper half space. And this means, because we have this translation as being a member of this group, this means that this function has to be one invariant, and every one invariant function has a Fourier expansion. And so the requirement is that this Fourier expansion is really starting in n equals zero, and so there won't be any negative coefficient in this Q. And if you make the story back, what Q means, Q is a kind of a local coordinate on a curve, and then this means that there should be no poles at this extra point. And this is why it's called holomorphic at infinity. And also, the remark I made before, there's this matrix S, there's this matrix minus one in SL2 set. And if I now consider the symmetry of this matrix minus one, this enforces you that your function should be the negative of your function, which is only possible if your function is vanishing. So this was the remark I made with Riemann zeta at three. It says, okay, this is a kind of extra symmetry you have in here. And now it is clear if we add two of these functions, then none of these conditions is violated in the sum, and therefore we can make a C-vector space out of them. And in this C-vector space, we can even consider a sub-vector space, namely those modular forms which have vanishing first zeros coefficient, so which start just with A1. Okay. And again, some easy proposition is that if we have modular forms of different weight, then there can't be any linear relation between them. Or in other words, the weight is a grading. Okay, let's see. I will be slow. Okay, suppose now we have some modular forms, F1, F2, up to Fm, and they have weights K1, K2, and so on. And if they would have the same weight, we can just consider them as being a modular form of a given weight Ki. And therefore, we can really assume that all have different weights. Okay, now we assume we have given a linear relation, which is just given here in the equation numbered with 1. And this is an identity of function. This means that this should hold for all tau in the upper half plane. And now we have to do with modular form. This means we can use the symmetries of these functions and look what is going to happen with this identity after the symmetry. And we get this equation, which is just the same equation where we applied this matrix S to all of these modular forms. But now we have the second property. Now we have a Fourier expansion. And now we look what is going to be with the Fourier expansion. And then we see, okay, for each of these, we have again this okay, now it's back. We get this I have it, okay. I was searching. This is new for me, and I love this technique, but it's the kind of first official talk I'm giving this technique, and I'm learning. Okay, and now this gives you lots of identities now for each Fourier coefficient. And now we just look at the first coefficient where this identity really occurs, because we know this is a sum starting with zero, but maybe it will start later. And and moreover, we can specialize this for particular taus. It should hold for all tau, but then in particular it holds for the tau which are purely imaginary. And so then this will be look even more nicely. And now we look at the smallest integers such that these an are non-zero. But now we can divide out this factor here, and we get an identity where we can now study the limit. Okay? But dividing a zero by some non-zero function, it's not making any problem, so the right-hand side will stay zero. But the left-hand side will be now become a polynomial with a property that this polynomial is going to be zero when the variable is going to infinite, which is completely nonsense. So this means that the beginning, the first assumption that there should be a linear relation, could not hold. So what we've seen now, that modular forms with different weight will never interfere linearly, and therefore we have really a graded ring structure on this space of modular forms, because we see once we multiply these modular forms, there will be again modular forms, but the weight will add up. And so we have now a ring of modular forms. And now if you have a ring of modular forms, you want to see whether there are interesting elements in there. It could be that the zero function is the only modular form, and then it would be an empty theory, and so it will be nice to have elements. And the most famous ones are the Eisenstein series, and for this we consider k an even number, and then we define this Eisenstein series by this sum here. And for this sum, it is important that we don't want to have a pole here, and the only pole we could get is when m and n is zero. Otherwise, this will be always contain some non-negative imaginary part, and we will never add an imaginary number with some integer to become zero. So the only chance this becomes zero is when m and n are zero, and this is this dot here, which is indicating that we take out the zero in Z2. Okay, this is the first remark. The second remark is that many of the properties we will see in a minute for this Eisenstein series does not depend on this factor in front. So this factor in front is a kind of normalization, and for different purposes you have a different normalization factor, and I try to keep the normalization of Don Saquier, and usually he's very bright when it corresponds to sort numbers in a correct way. So sometimes if you have an expression, you could make the brackets in either ways, but sometimes it's like it's better 2 times 2 pi i than 4 pi i. So sometimes it's better to have the 4 pi times I, but sometimes it's better to have the 2 pi i in bracket times 2. And so this is the reason why the bracketing, for example, in this is now the 2 pi i to the k. And we know that, I think this is enough to say. And so the theorem we want to show is that these Eisenstein series are modular forms whenever the k is big enough. Namely, if it's bigger than 4. And also, we have a very nice Fourier expansion in the sense that the first and all other following coefficients are given by some nice arithmetic function, namely, it is given by the powers of the divisors of your number n. And the next property is that this Riemann-Setter function is occurring in the zeros coefficient, but we don't have to worry on this because we've seen already at the beginning that the even values of Riemann-Setter function are some powers of pi. And so actually we end up that the zeros coefficient of this Eisenstein series is just a rational number. So we get really some nice power series with rational coefficient. And even more, we know that the denominator is bounded, because only the denominator of these Bernoulli numbers and this 2k are what is the denominator, and therefore if we really want to have integer coefficients, there's only a few sets of primes. We have to multiply these eigenstates to get integral coefficients. And again, having modular forms with integral coefficient is some very nice feature, and actually a lot of modern arithmetic is relying on the existence of these, but for just this ring structure, we don't have to care about this at this point. And another point is, for various purposes, it is also very nice to have this first coefficient to be one, and this is so important that we give a different symbol for it. So if we have ek, then we have the first coefficient to be one, and gk means, no, sorry, the zeroth coefficient is one for ek, and the first coefficient is one for gk. Okay, so how to prove this theorem? Again, this is a standard calculation. Maybe at this point I should say that most of these results I'm presenting here are not difficult to prove in the sense that once somebody told you the trick how to prove it, you can just follow it by a first year bachelor's mathematics. And so it's just some kind of elementary manipulation in algebra, a little bit of complex analysis. So it's not so difficult, and maybe you should see this as a point as being a manifestation of what Eichler said, that you have five kinds of mathematics. So it's addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and modular forms. And so the people spent a lot within the last 100 years of making this theory being very smooth in the sense that you can follow with not so much with not so much previous knowledge. And it is kind like a textbook of linear algebra. If you look at the textbook of linear algebra, then you can really look at the books 100 years ago, or Hardy and Wright in analysis. So there had not been a big change, but if you go to modern subjects, then you see it takes a while until a subject gets smooth, and this material here is already very smooth worked out. Okay, so we want to prove that these eigenstates are modular forms. So the first is we have to show it satisfies these symmetries, and now we do this by brute force. So we just plug in this a tau plus b and c tau plus d, and we put this in here. So this is just a substitution. And now what we are doing is just having this double fraction. We can resolve double fraction by taking the lower part to the up. So we get the c tau plus d in here. Then we have some c tau plus d coming in front of the n, and now we have this sum here. But now what is going to happen? So we have now just an action of an element of SL2Z on this lattice, but we are summing up over all points in the lattice except of the zero. But in this change of variables, the zero is mapped to zero and all non-zeros are mapped to another one in bijection. So summing up over this set of numbers or summing up over the others is just the same, and therefore we get that this eigenstates transforms like a modular form. So this is just the various property of SL2Z, that the lattice is unchanged with an action by SL2Z. Okay, so we see that it transforms like a modular form, and now the next point is we want to calculate its Fourier expansion. And for this, we will use a formula from complex analysis, which is a so-called Lipschitz formula. It says that if you sum 1 over z plus n to the k over all integers, and you assume that z is not itself an integer, so it's set in C on a, without the integers, then you can make up this series here, because now you see this is one periodic, and then you can make the Fourier expansion, and then you get this formula here, and you can prove this either by what the people call the Poisson summation, or you can find out that this is nothing else than the cotangent, and then you can make this formula here. So it's a formula I would like to take as a black box. But now, if we make this, then we sum over this lattice, and then we have a kind of two sets which we want to sum, namely the set where we have no tau, which is the first one. And the other one where they are the taus. But now the set where they are the taus, we can make the, oops, sorry. We can make use of this formula, and maybe we make Lipschitz. M tau. Instead of Z. So we just apply this formula, but now we just make, instead of the Z above, we make it with M tau, and now we get this identity here, but now we can just collect the terms that have the same Q coefficient, and then we see that it's just given by this divisor sum. Okay, and here we see again this Riemann zeta function. So we see that by elementary manipulation of power series, we can prove this theorem as soon as we know this Lipschitz formula, and we are done. Okay, so we could now write down these Fourier expansions, and so it's nice to see these Bernoulli numbers, so they are changing signs, and so on. And now, what kind of miracle we see? For example, we will see that 120 of g4 to the square equals g8, and then we can compare these coefficients, and then we get what is called as Hurwitz identity, that the sum over the divisors to the seventh power can be expressed in terms of the sums of the divisors in the third power, and if you want to calculate sigma 7 of 3, you see it behaves like the following. And it is quite elaborate to prove this result just. So you could give this just as an exercise, and to prove this identity, and if you really want to do it without using modulo, this can be done. This has been done, for example, in a paper by the daughter of Rankine, where she's proving this identity, and it's some paper, some site, some pages you have to do. The next point is now we could go the other direction to say, okay, we have calculated this Eisenstein series for even k greater equal than 4, why not just plug 2 into the formula? It can be done on the level of Q-series. Then we can define a Q-series G2, which is all Eisenstein series are modular forms, but no, the Eisenstein series have non-vanishing Fourier coefficient. The zeros is non-vanishing, but you can take linear combination of powers of Eisenstein series to get vanishing of this coefficient. It will become slightly different if you go to a higher level. Then I think it may happen that you can cancel this coefficient if you make a different play of different level and so on. But usually Eisenstein series or theta series have the property that you have a non-vanishing zeros coefficient. And coming back to Mike's point is that it doesn't make sense to define this Eisenstein series of way 2 by just mimicking this sum, because it won't converge absolutely. So you could either make a clever arrangement and to say, okay, we define the series by the following arrangement, but the more conceptual way is to make a process of regularization by introducing some converge enforcing factor, which is in this case this additional factor here. It makes you the sum convergent as soon as the S has real part bigger than zero. So it's a really absolutely nicely convergent function. And then you use the process of holomorphic continuation and to say, okay, let's go to the limit and take the limit point as being the definition of your function. And maybe a side remark for the experts. You can also take the weight zero non-holomorphic Eisenstein series and just take a holomorphic derivation. And then you see that the pole in S is vanishing. And then you also get almost the proof you have for the next slide, just in one go. But at this point, it's better to just say this Hecke trick is enforcing convergence and take the limit, which is making your converging factor to be one. And now, if you do this precisely and carefully, you will see that this G2 star is almost the same as your G2. It is up to this additional guy here, but now it is quite easy to calculate what is the action of this SL2 set on the imaginary part. Then you really see that this strange factor here has to do with the action of SL2 set on imaginary parts. And then we see that this function is behaving nicely with respect to SL2 set as a modular form of way 2. And now we know what's going to happen with the action on this point, and therefore we get this functional equation for this Q series G of G2. It behaves like a modular form, but there's something additional coming up, and this is what people called modular form, and there are many aspects of modular forms that can be put over to these quasi-modular forms, and we will see a little bit of this later. I think the best is you just calculate this, and then you can express this in terms of Bessel's functions, and then you know how Bessel's functions behave, and then you use this. Okay, I would like to, if I were the guy, I would prove it by using this non-holomorphic Eisenstein series, and therefore, for this, you can calculate the Fourier expansion with terms of Bessel functions. You find this, for example, in Zakier's notes. He's doing this. And therefore, you know the Fourier expansion of this for a real part of S then there's also some functional equation. I think this is maybe a point for the exercise class. Okay? So it's not too difficult, but maybe we don't have the knowledge right now. It's a kind of classic point. Yes, I'm pretty sure. Okay. At least I want to make a first aside now. If you have Q series, then you may ask whether other Q series are the same. And for example, for this, let's say, relevant part of the Eisenstein series, we have identities that it can be given as a Lambert series, which helps you, for example, if you want to put these modular forms in the computer, then it is clear that you won't need an exact expression for your function. So it may be you need something that is converging quite quickly and nicely to your modular form. And therefore, you just calculate a certain number of these coefficients, and for example, this Lambert series, or even what we see below, is helping you much better to efficiently program these modular forms. And so the first one is, I think, well known, but maybe not so well known is the following. That's a so-called polylogarithm, which is given by a variation of what you know, which is the expansion of the logarithm, more precisely of logarithm of 1 minus 1 plus z, which is z to the n over n. But now we have n to the s, and to make this work, we assume s is in n. And now, if you look at this, so you could view this as a kind of derivation, s-time derivation of the geometric series, but then you will get some additional Zamans, and this can be eliminated by considering certain polynomials in the nominator here. And so you have this identity, and the polynomials that occur here are the so-called Eulerian polynomials, which have been studied in various places. And using this, you could view this divisor, the sum over this divisor sums, you can write these as a Q average over this polylogarithm. So it's a kind of negative Q average polylogarithm. And you see there's a tiny but important difference. Here you have this 1 minus Q to the n, and here you have 1 minus Q, and the bracket is outside to the n. That's the slight difference in this denominator. Okay, now you have this identity, but Now, what is going on? Now you could view this Eisenstein series as a Q zeta value, and why you could you do? Are you allowed to do this? So the first one is that you have the so-called Q integers. So these are deformation of integers with this parameter Q, in the sense when Q goes to 1, you get your integer back again, which is attributed to Gauss. So Gauss invented this by studying Q deformations of binomial coefficients. And so you have this here. And the other point is, if you have these Eulerian polynomials and you evaluate this in 1, then one could show this is given by the faculty. And now, if you play this game with the Eisenstein series, we see, we ignore at this point the issue of bringing this limit in a different order with the sum, but this can be done. So we just bring this inside here, and then we have this Q integer here. So this is nothing else than the Riemann zeta function in K. And the K minus 1 faculty is just coming from the fact that this Eulerian polynomial had this K minus 1 faculty as value in 1. Okay, I come back. So it's, let's call it the jet lag. Formula, and I will resolve this. This is easy. Sorry, I'm just standing next to me. Okay. So this is just an aside, and we will come to this point in the last lecture, and we will see this again. And okay, I made this tonight, and maybe it was too quick. Okay. Now, why modular forms? So we had these slides by studying the action of the modular group on the upper half space. And now, why are functions like modular forms interesting? And so the point is that modular forms of weight k correspond to homogeneous functions on lattices. And this is helping you later when you want to have a nice explanation of so-called Hecker operators, but this is just to put you into the framework. And the other remark is, so modular forms are sections of a line bundle. The modular curve. And somehow you see that this C tau plus D corresponds to a so-called co-cycle, and the co-cycle defines you a line bundle, and so you have a geometric interpretation of your modular form. So you have, again, these 3 points of view. Either these are these functions having this strange functional equation and some additional property, or you say these are homogeneous functions on a lattice, or you say these are sections of a line bundle on a curve. So you have 3 pictures of the same object, and usually if you have various pictures, it allows you to prove theorems, because the main point is you transfer your property you cannot prove in one theory, you transfer it to the other, and then if you do it nicely, it will be easy in the other theory. Okay. And now we come to the discriminant function, and now I feel obliged to say this is given by the following expansion. And this is what we've heard before. Ramanujan. Tau function. So the Fourier coefficient of this discriminant is a very famous object. It's called Ramanujan's tau function, and later we will see that these are multiplicative functions and they have a kind of recursive properties, prime powers. And at this point, it will be just given as this infinite product. And because we could use just this product representation in order to prove modularity. And how we prove this? So we take the holomorphic derivative of the log of this function, and then it will be given by this formula here. So the logarithm is going to transform to some addition. And now the first one is easy. So if I take the derivative of tau, so it's just the one. And here we get this n to the q or to the n, 1 minus q to the n. So this is exactly the formula we've seen in this aside in weight 2. And now, again, the same thing. We see this is the sum over the divisors of n. And we see the minus 1 over 24, because we scaled everything a little bit. So we get just 48 pi g2 of tau. This is a function we have introduced before. And now we have a modular transformation of this G2, and this gives us this modular transformation of this logarithmic derivative of delta. But again, we know that this logarithm is transferring products into sums, and now we go back in this direction, and so we see this additive property is going to be a multiplicative change, but it could be that some constant is being killed by the logarithm. But now we apply that we have a Q series, so it is invariant under the translation by one, and therefore it is one for this translation. So it's sorry. And also, if we apply this mirroring, we see that this additional factor has to be 1. And therefore, we get it is 1 for every element, because we have seen this for the generators. And therefore, we get the modularity for this delta function. I think I take this, and after this, I make the stop. Okay. So far, we did only manipulations of Q series, but now we use a property that we are dealing with a function, and a function we can integrate. And the outcome of making integration is that the weight determines you the divisor of this function. So there's this theorem by Cauchy that if you integrate d log f over a circle, then it gives you the number of zeros minus the number of poles inside the circle. And we apply this now for the fundamental domain, and we want to count the numbers of zeros and poles inside the fundamental domain. First of all, we see, because we are dealing with holomorphic functions, there will be no poles, there will be only zeros. And now there's some slight difficulties, namely in the point I, which is in here, because somehow we cannot make the circle around. We only have a half circle, and we have these points in the corner, this omega, where we could just make a third of a circle around of these. And this gives you somehow the idea why we get only a half a zero or a third of a zero at these points. And for the other points, if it's on the boundary, we can just change the fundamental domain without changing the property of being a fundamental domain, because it just has to be not the same after translation by one. And so this will be fine. And so we could make this contour integration and get this result that the degree of the divisor of a modular form is given by k over 12. And this is a kind of important result, because the corollary is that it really gives you a nice description how many modular forms you have in a particular weight. So it tells you that in weight zero, you have just the constants. In weight two, you have none. And we already know that for odd weight, we don't have modular forms. Then if you look at the possibilities, what is going to solve this equation in weight k equals 4, 6, 8, 10, and 14, then you see you have only one possibility, because if the function is having, must have a, let's say, a pole in a zero in I, all functions that have a zero only in I, if you divide them, then it has to be a modular form of weight zero, which has to be a constant, and therefore you know this space has to be one-dimensional. And again, if you're in this exceptional set, then you know there won't be any chance of having a zero in infinity, so there will be no cusp forms. And in weight 12, you have the possibility, namely of one cusp form, and but you know delta, and therefore you know this. And then if you have a zero in infinite, you can divide by delta, because delta has no zero inside, and therefore you get this map that the ring of modular forms can be seen as a direct sum of the space spent by Eisenstein series of weight k and the cusp forms of weight k. And so I think I stop here, and I will continue tomorrow morning. Thank you. But maybe you have to speak very loud, because it is quite a noise of the air conditioning, and so. But what are the Bernoulli numbers? Eulerian polynomials. So you could take Eulerian polynomials as being the only polynomials that do satisfy the property we've seen. So you could take this as being the definition for these Eulerian polynomials. So you see, you have this identity here, you have this power series, and if you multiply this power series by this factor here, then you will see quite easily that something that is coming out is a polynomial, and this gives you a definition of Eulerian polynomials. But maybe your question is more like, can you give me another definition of Eulerian polynomials? And there are definitions. There's a nice paper by Hirzebruch, and there's a nice paper by a guy called Foata. I will write this down because maybe my spelling is... And I think it's called Eulerian. No, but these polynomials are all have a kind of similar thing, so that you have a kind of Pascal triangle for the coefficients. They satisfy differential equations, they satisfy some recursion. And so there's a long list of identities describing these polynomials, and they are not, in the German we have a distinction between Euler-Sche polynom and Euler polynomial. So it's not Euler polynomials and Eulerian polynomials. These are kind of different polynomials. So it's, Euler is so famous that he has two kinds of polynomials that gave his name.